problem in the Corinthian church. Because on their communion Sunday, everybody would bring food. As a matter of fact, every Sunday, they would have a potluck, as it were, in church. Everybody would bring food, but there were some people who could not afford to bring anything. They were poor. So before communions, they would eat all this food. And there were some who didn't get any food, and some had their tummies full, their stomach filled to the brim, and they didn't share with those who had none. And Paul said, this is not a real communion service. This is not a real supper, because that's why it's called Lord's Supper. This is not a real supper, because some of you have eaten your stomach full, and there are those among you who are hungry. So eat at home. Eat at home. Don't bother bring any food.
That's right.
Let's just come and have communion. And you eat at home. If this is the way you're going to behave, if you're that hungry, eat at home. There was no brotherly love, no sharing, no caring. Brotherly kindness. The word kindness here is really love. Love. The word kindness here in the Greek is phileo, from which you get the word Philadelphia. That's why Philadelphia is called what? The city of brotherly love. It's from this Greek word, phileo. And this is a virtue that Peter must have acquired the hard way. You remember John chapter 21? John chapter 21 speaks of the two kinds of love referred to right here in 1 Peter chapter 2, chapter 1, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 7. Jesus said to Peter, Peter, son of John, agapa o me, do you love me? Lovest thou me more than these? Agapa o me. Peter responded, me phileo se. Two different love. He did not respond to Jesus the way Jesus asked him. Jesus asked him, do you love me sacrificially? Peter answered, you know I love you like a brother. I love you like a brother. You know I have deep affections for you. I love you. You are my good friend. And Jesus said, are you? And Jesus started to ask him on his term, phileo me. Jesus never asked him the second time about the agapao. He asked him now, are you really my friend? Are you? Do you really have that affection for me? Do you really love me like a brother? Peter said, you are the omniscient one. You know all things. I can't fool you. Peter knew that from the first question Jesus asked him, that he can't fool Jesus. That's why he answered him correctly. You see, sometimes we bow before God and we begin to tell him too many words. But you have to remember that God knows your heart. Yes. Amen?
Amen.
So talk to him in context. Because he knows your heart. He knows our heart. There's nothing you can tell him that he doesn't know. Brotherly kindness. Peter understood that. You saw it in the play last night, and it is real. These disciples bickered among themselves. They quarreled all the time about who Jesus loves more. What should be done properly and what wasn't done properly. They were normal human beings. They bickered, they fought against each other. In words, they loved each other though. They would come back together. I guess sometimes Jesus just sat back and said, let me watch them now. Look at these children. Look at them. So they debated highly among themselves, because one, they didn't really know who Jesus was. They were following him, but they did not understand his purpose. If we love Jesus Christ, we must also love the brethren. Brotherly kindness speaks to brotherly love and sisterly love. The special love and affection that exists between Christians, brothers and sisters, those within the loving family, the way you love your siblings. We in the church are siblings.
Hallelujah. Amen.
We are brothers and sisters in the Lord. And let me tell you something. When you get saved and you have a brother or a sister who is not saved, you have a closer relationship with your brother and your sister in the church. Amen. Than that with that unsaved brother or sister that you have in your family. Why? Because you are born again into the family of God.
Amen.
You now celebrate a new birth.
Amen.
You now celebrate a new birth. You have a new name written down in glory. And it's not Smith or Johnson or Clark or anything. It's a new name that the Lord says he's going to give to you in a stone that only you will know. For now, your new name is Christian. You belong to a new nation, a new people. You're called Christians. Therefore, we are called upon to love each other. We are called upon to have great affection for each other. Not any kind of sinful affection, but a great affection of brotherly and sisterly love. for opportunity. As we have therefore this time that is given unto us, this day that is given unto us, you don't know about tomorrow. Don't plan to love me tomorrow. Don't plan to show me affection tomorrow. Show me that affection today. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good to all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith, especially to your brother and sister in the Lord. It's the kind of love that Peter called the unfeigned love of the brethren, and commanded us to see that we love one another with a pure heart in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. He says, seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart. Pure heart, the heart of Jesus. A pure heart. A pure heart. Fervently. 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 Ectinous. Fervently. Earnestly. Sincerely. I love you with the love of the Lord. I love you with the love of the Lord. Nothing can come messy of that kind of love. You know that? Nothing can come messy of that kind of love. It's the love of the Lord. That's why Paul says, kiss the brethren with a holy kiss. Not a corrupted kiss. Not a fleshly desire kiss. But with a holy kiss. You're to love one another. Brethren, you're to take up for each other. When you hear your unsaved friends maligning your church brother or your church sister, you don't join with them. No. I went to a church the other day and the pastor was preaching against pastors because what he heard his unsaved friends say about pastors. And I was shocked that the man was up there preaching against his brothers and his sisters. And I'm saying, what kind of thing is this? It's an internal battle going on. But we are to take up for each other and don't get involved in the argument. If you can't solicit the goodness of your brother or your sister, say, we're not going to talk about her. We're not going to talk about him. That's my brother. That's my sister. So we're not going to discuss that because you're not part of the family. This is a family business. Okay? I won't stand up with anybody and malign my brother. No. It's a family business. And if you're doing it, you're wrong. You have to refrain from doing it. Whether it's be with your children, if they don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you say, no, the argument stops right here, right now. Because you're not going to talk about my brother and sister that way. So we're not going to discuss the church. Because you don't know the Lord of the church. When you hear that kind of thing, you walk away from it. I don't care who is talking to you about it. Because they're not part of the family of God. So you don't discuss family business with outsiders. You are to have brotherly kindness. Add brotherly kindness. Mix it up right. Because you're one of moral excellence. Because you're one of the who has the knowledge of the love of Jesus Christ. Because you're one who has learned how to be temperate, how to be patient. The world doesn't have that. You have that. You're given that by the Holy Spirit. You have to add brotherly love. My friends, sometimes we get caught up into our own selves so much that we forget that there are others around us. We are so caught up in our own worries and our troubles that we fear to bear in mind that there are others around us who have problems too. Step out of yourself for a while. Don't be so cautious to love one another. Some of us are so cautious to show love. We might just get in trouble by showing love. Show it anyway. Show brotherly kindness anyway. If it's rejected, show it again. Somebody will get it. You don't want anything from them, you're giving them. I want to deal with these two loves today. I was going to separate them. But because we're coming up on a new season of Advent, I'm trying to go through this. So he said, show the phileo love, the brotherly love, the Philadelphia. That must exist within the church because that's the foundation love of every marriage. The problem with some married couple is that they're not friends first. Amen? You got me? They're not friends first. There's not that affection between them of respectability and affection between them before they get married, before they jumped into the agapao love. So the agapao love cannot manifest itself because there was no foundation laid in the relationship with the phileo love. I don't know if you got that. There's got to be a foundation laid. The phileo love, the Philadelphia love, the affectionate love, the brotherly love. You know, some people have better relationship with outsiders than their spouse. And that's hard. Because there's no friendship in the relationship. You know, sometimes I'm not talking about us, but my wife and I know the neighbors wonder what we laugh about so much. Yesterday I told her, my wife asked me, how much are those nuts that they sell there at that place again? Because she was budgeting her trip. Uh-huh. I said, I don't know, but my mother didn't pay anything for me. This nut was free. So we laughed about it. We laughed about it. You've got to laugh at yourself sometimes. We laugh, we make joke of things, some serious things too. But you make joke of it because you don't take it personal. You laugh about it. You know? Like when you go on the trip, you got to separate Sister Malcolm and Sister Duncan.
Amen.
That's a comedy.
Because they're sharing the love. They have that camaraderie. They can rebuke each other and still laugh about it. That's sibling love. That's how children behave among children. They love each other that kind of way. And you dare not go between them because you're going to get in trouble. So let that love exist between you. But you also need charity. Charity. You know, in the New Testament church, I'm going to be a little bit longer today. In the New Testament church, especially among Pentecostalism, and I love Pentecostals. I've preached in Pentecostal church, Church of God, all of those churches. But they put more emphasis on speaking in tongues than loving each other. And that's where they get it wrong. Tongues are essential. They are good. They are part of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit manifested himself through the speaking of tongues in the New Testament church. Not everybody gets the gift because not everybody seeks the gift. But they placed a lot more emphasis on that than this that is called charity. They forgot that when the New Testament church started, the people sold everything they had and split up the equity among themselves so that all men would have equal. The agapao, or the agape love, is the Calvary love. Say amen.
Amen.
That's the Calvary love. This is a self-sacrificing love. So you are to add to your brotherly love the horizontal love. The horizontal love that you have, you now need a vertical perspective of that love, and that is the Calvary love. The agape love, the self-sacrificing love, a love that gives itself for the person loved.
Amen.
It's not word of mouth anymore. It's not a mere shaking of hands and saying, I love you with the love of the Lord, or we are one in the bond of love. It's not just that smile on your face. It goes deeper than that. It is a self-sacrificing love, the giving of yourself without murmuring and complaining.
Amen.
Oh God, I feel the Spirit this morning. Speak, Holy Spirit. The giving of ourselves. It is the kind of love that demands something of us. The supreme measure and example of this agape love is the love of God for us. Here's what the verse says. For God so loved that he gave. Hallelujah. For God so loved that he gave his only. Say his only.
His only.
Say his only.
His only.
Which of you have only $5 in your pocket and I ask you for it, you're going to give it to me. I know you will do it. picture you have the last $5 in your pocket, and your church sister and your church brother come to you and express that need, and you're going to take it out and give it to them. Which of you have an only child? Let me ask you more intimately now. One child, one son, one daughter, and it is required of you. Will you give it? You can't even release them to live on their own. They can't breathe the way you're holding them tight. But God so loved you and me that He gave His only begotten Son. Yet we refrain from self-sacrifice. You won't even give up your seat in church. You won't even give up your seat in church if it's demanded of you. I'm not so talking to global. Global people are not like that. There are some folks watching us. But that's the supreme measure, an example of the agape love, God's love for us. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have something greater, everlasting life. And He does not covet that.
Praise the Lord.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Some of you won't give because you covet that somebody's going to, you feel somebody's going to be better off than you. But until you reach that place where you can release yourself from that bondage, you will not be able to love unconditionally. Amen? You've got to love. Love vaunteth not itself. Love is not puffed up. It's good to have faith and hope. But there are nothing without love. The greatest of these is love. All of these virtues that Peter spoke about, the virtue, the knowledge, the temperance, the patience, all of this without charity.
Amen.
Charity is the topping. That makes the good bitter chocolate taste better. Hallelujah!
Amen. Amen.
Charity tops it off. Charity completes the mixture. Without a charity, you're not serving God's delight. You're not serving God's delight. That's somebody else's delight. It's not God's. The whole thing is off. It doesn't taste good. This recipe is a different recipe. When I go to one restaurant more than once, I know when the chef is changed. Okay? I'm using a different recipe, and this one tastes off. My regular chef is not here today. Well, when you don't have the kindness and the charity mix up into all that God, Peter talked about first, the recipe is off and it's going to not taste so good. Amen?
Amen.
You got to have that in there. Because that agape love demands something greater of us. It demands ourselves. And the greatest demonstration of this love that has ever been known, is Calvary, the cross of Calvary, where Jesus was hung up and strung up for you and me. And he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Where he says, this day shalt thou be in paradise with me. Mother, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. He says, I thirst. Then he didn't get weary of doing that on the cross. He did it to the end, where he said, it is finished. He said, it is finished. It was love that went the whole yard. Glory to God.
Amen.
It was that agape love that went and did it and did the whole yard. Oh man, that last mile of Jesus, that last minute, those last hours of Jesus were long. Oh God, they were weary, and he had the power to come down from the cross, but he knew that the love was to finish the job. Don't you want that kind of love? It's a giving love, it's not a taking love. Some people are takers, not givers. Give me all the love you can give me, but they have nothing to give back. They are destitute of that kind of love. My friends, rejoice in your heart when God tells you to be kind to the brethren, to be sacrificial to the brethren. The evidence of Christ's unwavering love, the evidence of God's unwavering love, is the sacrifice of his son for this whole sinful world. For God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, undeserving, deserving of only one thing, the songwriter says, what love you have that I, a child of hell, child of hell, child of hell, should be saved. What a love you have. And the only thing I deserved was hell. But Jesus came, just like he lifted Peter out of the water, he lifted you and me. He lifted you and me. We were sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry.
Yes.
And he reached deep down, glory to God. Deep down, deep, deep down. You know, deep, deep down, deep down. Because
yes.
I was swallowed up by the mire. And he lifted me up. He lifted me up and he says, come walk with me. Come walk with me. That's the kind of love you are to have toward each other. The love that lifts your brother and sister who's buried in despair. Do you have that kind of love? That's the kind of love Jesus demonstrates today. I'm not talking about your siblings first. I'm talking about your brother and sister in the Lord. This is the kind of love that knows no boundaries, my friends. There's no limit to this kind of love. It's hard to love some people so much, isn't it? You just keep giving your love, giving your love, giving your love, and you're getting nothing in return. But God says you are to give it not expecting anything in return. And if everyone practices that, everyone will be giving to each other. So there will be a return. It is a sacrificial love that goes to the end. It's not seeking, it is giving. It is a love that is never selfish, never self-serving, and never self-seeking. So we are friends. We have brotherly kindness and sisterly kindness. We're affectionate one to another. That's why we sincerely greet each other and love each other. Stand in defense of each other. But the laughter this morning may change into crying and sorrow this evening, because one of your sisters or your brother has a need that they must be brought out of. How are you going to handle that? We were just laughing this morning, but this evening the tide changes. How are you going to handle that? Is that self-sacrificing love? That reaches out and embraces somebody and say, I'm here for you. I got your back. I got your back. Whatever it is, we're going to help you. Whether it's collectively or individually. That phone call is made. You know, sister so-and-so and brother so-and-so has a need. And we get on that phone, and without criticizing or being too judgmental over the matter and blaming them for creating the situation they're in, we've got to get them out. Why? Because that's our brother. That's our sister. God bless you as you meditate on these this week. Love each other with the love of the Lord. Brotherly love and self-sacrificing love. Amen.
Praise the Lord. You had a wonderful weekend because you had many examples of love this weekend. You know, it was a wonderful weekend so much. And I have to admit, when the morning started, I said something to my wife that was dumb and upset. It was. And then once I realized it just that quick, I had to shut up and drive. And I got here and she was kind of upset with me. And I saw that love on the bus, and it said it was infectious. And I said, I got to get a part of this too. And it saved the day for me.
Amen.
You know, that's why I kept saying all the trip, I said, the greatest resource we got right now is one another. And it went all the way to Pennsylvania, and you saw that show, and God showed it to you again. And you came home singing the hymns on the bus. You know, we worked together, and we took care of the bus, and we were in fellowship even on the breaks. Amen. Hallelujah. So give Jesus the praise for the love he showed you first. And he showed us the way, and it was alive yesterday, and it's alive today. If you need a dose, just remember that joy. Don't leave that love on that bus. Don't leave it here in this church this morning. Amen? Glory to God. Hallelujah. The invitational hymn, number 589, in your hymn.
And my sisters, love is a verb. It's a doing word. Amen?
Amen.
It's not something you just say out of feigned lips. It's something you must mean when you say it. Amen?
Amen.
You must love one another as the Lord has loved us. God, we thank you for your love. We thank you that you set that great example for us on Calvary. Lord, we repent because we have not loved as we ought to love. We are sorry. And we ask you to forgive us. We ask you to cleanse our hearts, to give us pure hearts, hearts that are able to love like you love, to love one another as you have loved us. bless us now as we practice this love. As we add this, Lord God, and it strengthens our faith. It makes our faith strong, because as we talk about our conviction, no one will be able to say, yes, but you don't love each other. They'll be able to say, truly, you are his disciple, because you love one another. Bless us now, we pray. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn number 208. 508. Forgive me. 508. Love lifted me.
This holy life that you have bestowed. God, we go rejoicing because we have been wrapped up in your love. God, you've been so faithful this whole weekend. God, send us on our way rejoicing of the love that we have one for another, that it first came from you because you so love Global Evangelistic Ministries. You love your church, God, and you have blessed us. Let us rejoice and be active in the love that you have provided, that we would go and show love to someone else, that they would know that it is a God up above that loves them dear. Bless us and keep us, we pray, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Please raise your hands for the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you, and the Lord give you peace now, henceforth, and forevermore. God bless you. Take Jesus with you. Go home, have your dinner, sleep for an hour, be back here for 6.